past week, I kind of introduced everything and said, you know, we have battles, we have struggles, but the thing is, there's a battle behind the battle. There's a struggle behind the struggle. And that struggle is a spiritual struggle. And I don't know if that freaks you out or not. If you're not a Christian, I'm so glad you're here. You're not a follower of Jesus. This is one of those things where we're a little bit weird. We got to admit that sometimes, that we believe in a God that can't be, you don't see him, yet you see him everywhere. We believe in God who is unseen. And so we believe in spiritual things. And so we believe that there are battles that are spiritual. And even Christians sometimes struggle to believe that, right? You ever go, man, this is a little weird. He's getting into some weird stuff today. We're kind of going into some weird ground. Let's get on to the next series. Can we talk about something else? Because you're talking about battles behind battles, things I can't see. But the reality is, it's true. And Paul talked about this in the book of Ephesians, and we camped out there last week as we kind of set this series up. And I want to bring that scripture back to us again today, because it really tells us about the battle behind the battle, the spiritual battle that exists in our lives, and how to be prepared. See, that's the goal. Too many of us are walking into the battles we face every day naked, spiritually. Like, we don't have what we need. And Paul writes to tell us in Ephesians, this is 2,000 years ago, he was telling the early church this, what we need for the daily struggle. So here's what he says, Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse 10. He says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Already he's getting into the battle behind the battle, isn't he? For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. So often we think the battle is about the person next to us or about the sin or the addiction or this or that, whatever. Sometimes it's in our minds, all these battles. But what he's saying is we're battling things that we can't even see sometimes. Flesh and blood. It's not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, authorities, powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. This is the battle behind the battle, friends. Therefore, stop there for a moment. When I was in seminary, one of the greatest lessons I was taught is when you're reading something like this in Scripture, when you see a therefore, you should ask what it's there for. I'm just a simple man. That really hit me. And so Paul says, therefore. That means you got to go back to what he just said. Okay, because there's a spiritual battle that exists, because of that, because it's not just what you see and touch, because there's a spiritual battle going on in our lives, because of that, put on, get dressed in the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to look, stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to still stand. Stand firm then. He says that three times. He doesn't want us to get knocked down. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Basically what Paul was saying, this is where I ended last week, where I want to pick up today. Paul was saying this, if I don't suit up, I'll be taken down. If you don't suit up, if you don't put on the armor of God, you will be taken down in the daily battles that you are in. And too many of us are living life without the armor that God gives us. What's crazy about this is not man-made armor. This is not man-made stuff. This is divine protection given to us by God for the battles. He knows what we need. And so I want to talk for the rest of this series about the armor, what it means to suit up. And so today we're jumping right in with the very first thing. There's a reason I think Paul talks about this first, belt of truth. All right, so I want to talk about the belt of truth, why it's called the belt of truth, what it means. First of all, though, we got to be reminded, if you weren't here last week, check out the message. You can see it online. But I want to mention just why Paul uses the image of armor. Why would he do that? When Paul wrote the letter to the Ephesians in the first century, when he wrote the letter that I just read to you part of, he was in jail. Paul spent about half his ministry in jail. Isn't that crazy? Can't imagine spending half my ministry in jail, but Paul did. And while he was there, he kept doing ministry. And so what he did was he wrote letters to the churches, and he wrote in a letter to the Ephesian church, and he sees guards walking by his cell. And when he sees these Roman guards, they would have looked like this. This was Roman armor, Roman soldier armor right here. This is basically what they wore. And so he was looking at them, and he's thinking, you know, as Christians, we need armor. And so this is the armor that we wear. So he took what he was seeing. Isn't that a good teachable moment? And then he used it to apply it to the church and the fact that we need to be wearing this armor. We need to suit up. So he starts by talking about the belt of truth. Why the belt of truth? Why did Paul connect it to Roman armor? And how does this help us in our daily struggles? You should know this. The very first piece of armor that would be put on by a Roman soldier was the belt. Why? Well, that they would put one thing on before that, all right? I want you to imagine a big, it was called a tunic, really, but it's kind of, it went under their armor. So it was like original Under Armour. Amen? That's a joke, man. Y'all are supposed to laugh at that. Because it was under their armor. But they basically, I was reading in a commentary about it, it was basically like a really big pillowcase with the head part cut out and the arms, and they would put this thing on. So you can imagine, some of y'all are going to dress your kids up like that for Halloween or whatever. They put this thing on, right? And it would be flowing. They didn't have cool fitted shirts like I got on here today. All right, they didn't have that. So they wore these big pillowcase type things. And then to make sure that stuff wasn't all loose during battle, you didn't want that loose during a battle, because what would happen? Like your arm would get caught in it and you couldn't use your sword or something. They had to cinch it up. They had to tie it up. They used a belt. They put on a belt and it pulled all of that undergarment type of stuff together. Not only that, the belt would hold the breastplate in place. Now, Roman breastplates, I didn't know this, it wasn't one big piece. It was a bunch of strips, because these Roman soldiers, they could walk 20 miles in a day in the heat wearing their armor. How crazy is that? They could run multiple miles. These guys were in shape, and they were wearing all this gear. It's like wearing football gear or something, or worse, you know, because it's metal and it's heating up. All right, so they're wearing all this, and so they would wear the belt, and they would kind of tie the breastplate together with the rest of it, and then they'd have this tunic on underneath. And if you look at a Roman guard, it comes down. It looks kind of like a skirt, right? Have you seen this in the movies and stuff? And the reason it was like that is so they could move freely and get about, but they had to have that belt on. In fact, it was the foundational piece of armor, and they would always wear it, even if they took all the other armor off, because it kind of held everything together. All right, so that's what it did. It had two purposes: hold the tunic in place, hold the breastplate in place. But not only that, that's one thing it did. It also would give them poise, kind of stand them up. We have terrible posture, man. You ever been told that? I get told that. You like slumping over. You put on a big old wide belt, what happens? You're like this, right? And so they would put on these belts, and it would give them poise, kind of pull their chest up, ready for the battle that they were going to be in. So that's what it did. Basically held things together for them and held them upright for battle. Think about that as Paul applies it to truth. They were just wearing a belt, but Paul looked at the Roman guards and said, that's like the belt of truth that we need to be wearing as followers of Jesus. Could there be a reason Paul used the word truth? Why didn't he call it the belt of righteousness? That's the breastplate of righteousness. Why'd he call it the belt of truth? Could it be that the things that I just said to you kind of apply to what truth does? Just like the belt, listen, the belt for the guard held the undergarment in place and kept them from getting too loose and out of line and out of sync. And just like it gave them the ability to fight well because they were wearing this and it gave them poise, listen, truth holds me together and readies me for battle. So every single day as you enter into life, as you enter into the world, you need to be thinking as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus, man, I got to get the belt of truth on today. In fact, you should never take it off, really. The Roman guards didn't, except for bathing or whatever. They wore these things all the time because they always had to be ready to go if something happened. So that's what it does, is it holds me together and it readies me for battle. Now, y'all know I'm talking about truth with like a capital T, right? When I say truth. But we live in a world where if I went around, everybody's got their own definition of truth. Is that right? Y'all understand that? That's so real today, that just so many definitions of truth. I'm talking about truth with a capital T. I'm talking about God's truth, whatever that is. I want to tell you what I think it is in just a few moments. But I gotta just say that we're talking about God's truth that's going to hold me together. Like the belt holds the soldier together. We're talking about God's truth. This is truth that's going to keep you, God's truth, or whatever that is, from getting tripped up. Anybody getting tripped up? You got tripped up this past week? Anybody in the house got tripped up this past week? Something took you down, right? Lies. Somebody told you, or you told yourself, or the enemy told you, or whatever. I mean, this is what happened. We need the belt of truth because so many of us are living in a world of lies. We all are. And we need this to hold us together. All right? So that's what truth does. All right. What is that truth? That's what I want to kind of turn to now and spend the rest of my time talking about today. And I got to tell you, it might not be the direction you thought I was going to go with this today. Or I don't even know if you even thought about it. I did a lot this week. In fact, partway through the week, as I started to kind of go in this direction that I'm going to go with this morning, I thought, is this the right direction to go? All the way up till this morning, right before the services started, I was like, man, I don't know. Is this the right direction to go? And I think it is. I think it is because we need to know what the truth is when we're talking about the battle that we live every single day. Can I tell you this? What is interesting, I think, is very often, listen, we get this wrong. We get this part wrong. What I mean is we get truth wrong and what truth is wrong. So what I want to do is ask this question. What is the truth that holds me together and readies me for the fight? What is that truth? If you're not a Christian, maybe the reason you're not is because you've been told what I'm about to share with you. You've believed that this thing was the truth, and the belt didn't fit. Just didn't work for you. You might have tried it for a little while. You're like, you know what, this Christianity thing, not for me. Maybe for the rest of y'all, but not for me. Many times people aren't Christians because of what I'm about to share with you. It's our definition of truth and what we tell them truth is. Listen, I think there's two people today that can be freed from what we're talking about. Number one, if you're not a Christian, you're not a follower of Jesus, maybe it's because you've been told what truth is and it's not really truth. Hang on, listen to what I'm about to say. But others of us, I say us, those of us who are Christians, need to be very careful with what we tell people truth is. Maybe you've been giving people the wrong version of truth. And it is intentional sometimes on the part of some Christians, but a lot of times it's not. It's unintentional, but we need to be intentional. We're talking about the truth, y'all, with a capital T, amen? I mean, we need to be getting it right. Would you agree with that? We need to be getting it right. So what is the truth that holds me together and readies me for the fight? All right, let me tell you what it's not. It's not religious rule keeping. See, that's what I think we tell people the truth is. Religious rule keeping. Do this, do that, live right, you're doing it wrong. All this kind of stuff. In the Old Testament, it was called the law. By the way, the Old Testament, a better phrase for it would have been because this is what Jesus called it, the old covenant. Covenant. And then Jesus said, I've come to bring guess what he said? New covenant. What does that mean about the old? Come on, what does it mean? It's obsolete. In the book of Hebrews, it actually says that. The old covenant, obsolete. This is where you get some of you Christians be like, church people, you throwing out the Bible? You throwing out the Old Testament? No. Hang on. Hang on. Y'all okay? Hang on. Now, I'm telling you, outsiders, people outside of church, those who may not follow Jesus or not sure about this church thing, you're liking what I'm saying already. But hold on. We often tie it to rules and regulations. I'm going to call it, because Jesus called it, religion. People get mad at me for that too. I've had people search me out after worship. You've heard me say this before and be like, I can't believe you said religion's bad. Jesus said it. There's a whole chapter in Matthew's gospel where, and Jesus is not a finger pointer, man. He does not point his finger, but he pointed a finger at the religious leaders. And he told them, you're doing the whole old thing. And here's what's worse about it. You're wearing church face. We talk about church face here at Quest if you're new. Here's what church face is. You're breaking rules and you're showing up on Sunday acting like you don't. How you doing? I'm good. How are you? Good. Everybody's good. Isn't that good? All y'all are always good. So am I. It is so hard to not wear church face. Let's just admit it. Because what are we doing? We're doing old covenant stuff, which is do it all right, live right, all this kind of stuff. And that's religious rule keeping. Jesus called it religion. Did Jesus want us to live right? Sure he did, but that's not what he started with. That's not what it's about. Here's my definition of religion, just my definition at its core. About living right. That sounds good, right? I mean, I want y'all to live right as the pastor of this church. But here's the thing. So we can earn God's love and salvation. His approval. If I just do it right, I screw up, I'll wear church face next week, no one's going to notice, I can hide my sin. So that's what happens when you live the religious life, is you got to hide it. You can't be real, because you're not supposed to do wrong, ever. And that's what the religious leaders were doing, and they were telling other people, you ain't good enough. Can I tell you something? Nobody's good enough. Nobody's good enough to earn God's approval. Nobody. Because if you sinned this past week, you're done. It's over for you. You can't get there on your own, earning God. So religious rule keeping actually kills us. It, like, ultimately, you are, if that's truth to you, you're going to take that belt, is you're either going to take it off and give up on it, or you're going to wear it so proudly and you're going to think you're better than everybody else. That's what religious people do. They have to be better than other people so that they feel good about themselves. Amen? You know what I'm talking about? This is what we do so often. Here's how you spot a religious rule keeper. You ready? This is what they say. Now, I'm not saying that this is always, I say this a good bit, I'm sure. But listen to my tone and how I say it too, all right? My wife's taught me that I have tone. I didn't realize that till I got married. Any other husbands in the room realize you got a tone? Some of you newly married, you're like, that's weird. My wife said the same thing. Yeah, you got tone. Here's what a religious rule keeper says to other people. The Bible says. You ever heard that? Sometimes you see him standing on a street corner with a megaphone shouting at you. The Bible says you're going to hell. If you don't get it right. You're living wrong. And we're pointing our finger. You're living wrong. By the way, we're telling that to people who don't even believe in Jesus a lot of times. What do you expect them to be living? You know? I mean, but that's what we do so often, is we talk about the book. The good book, right? The Bible. Don't throw me off stage. I'm not done. This sermon's not over, all right? For many of us, the truth, with a capital T, is the Bible. It's the book. And while the Bible contains the truth, with a capital T, the Bible is not the truth. The book is not the truth. All right, John, you're going to have to clean this mess up. What is true? What is truth? More than a book, you know, what really is the truth that's going to... See, because what I care about, y'all, seriously, man, the longer I'm the pastor of this church, what I care about is that you win the battles. that you win the battles, man. That you win in the struggle. You can defend yourself and you can live the life that God's called you to. That you can be successful in being a follower of Jesus. No matter what comes at you, because you're going to have stuff come at you. Amen. You're going to live the Psalm 23 life sometimes, which is walking through the valley of the shadow of death. It's going to be hard. So what is the truth that's going to help you with that? You ready? This is going to blow your mind. Jesus. Well, of course it's Jesus, John. The book talks about Jesus. Amen. How many of y'all spent time with Jesus this week? Right? How many of us have pointed our fingers and tell people how they're living and this and that, and the Bible says this and that, but we ain't spent a lick of time with Jesus? The truth. Jesus is the truth. A person is true, not the book. It's not about the book. Now listen, does the book talk about Jesus? Is the book true? Yes. Is the book true? Yes. Is the book the truth? No. Jesus is the truth. Even in the book, Jesus says this. It writes this. In John chapter 14, speaking about himself, Jesus said this, I am the way. The book is the truth. The law is the... No. What's the truth? I am the truth, Jesus says, and I am the life. I'm the truth with a capital T. I am the truth. So Jesus himself is the truth. And not only that, what Jesus did is the truth. What Jesus did, what Jesus do? Listen, this guy was nuts. Jesus, that is. He came into this world, he lived in this world, and he went around telling everybody, I'm gonna die. Now, any one of you could say that, people be like, well, that's true. But then he went further and he said, but I ain't gonna stay dead. I'm gonna be raised from the dead. I'm gonna be resurrected. You're gonna see me again. I'm gonna come back from the dead. Why am I a Christian? Me? It's because Jesus said something that was true, that was so unbelievable, but he did it. The reason I'm a Christian, the reason I follow Jesus is because he said he was gonna die. Okay, we can all say that, but then he said he was gonna be raised to new life, and he was. Friends, that is the truth. The truth is what Jesus said and what he did, the resurrection. And if you don't believe this is true, listen, if you're struggling with this in any kind of way, I'm not saying the Bible's bad. I'm trying to make a statement here, trying to get us to the point that we push past that a little bit, because so often what is true is not good enough, y'all. It's religious rule keeping. It's do this, do that. If I can just get myself cleaned up somehow, I'll be okay for God. No, no, no. You can't get yourself cleaned up. You need rescue. You need the new covenant. You can't do the old. Amen? I mean, you can't do the old. You can't keep the commandments. All y'all murdered somebody this week. Preacher, now you're stepping, nuh-uh. You, every person in this room, every one of you, murdered somebody this week. What are you talking about? Well, in the Old Testament, Ten Commandments says do not murder, doesn't it? I'm using an extreme one. If I said lie, you'd be like, well, okay, man. But you murdered somebody. How do I know that's true? Because Jesus in the New Testament, who is the truth, took it even further when his disciples were like, look, we keep the commandments. I mean, religious leaders, we keep the commandments. And then Jesus said, no, you murdered somebody. Here's how we murder people. Jesus said, have you ever been angry at somebody? So in the house today, have any of y'all been angry at somebody this week? This week, you murdered them, according to Jesus. See, you can't keep them. And I'll tell you this, some of you murdered me this week. And I done murdered a lot of y'all, I promise. Because I've been angry at some of y'all, and you've been angry at me, and so we've murdered. You're like, and this is what Jesus' disciples said. Who can follow, who can do this? Because see, they were still focused on what? The old covenant. We got to do this. We got to somehow keep these rules. I mean, I can't keep those rules. And Jesus is like, no kidding. That's why I'm here. I'll keep them. I'll fulfill them. I'll die in your place, and I'll be raised, watch this, to new life. Put that belt on and live your life. That will work. Because the truth, listen, are those things. Paul speaks about it not only in Ephesians. If you're struggling with this, I just want you to know what he says in Corinthians as well. Paul wrote another letter to a church, the Corinthian church. Look at what he says to them about the truth. He says, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you. All right, the message which you received and on which you have taken your stand. So you're standing on this as the foundation of your life. This is the truth right here. All right, so let's go on. What does it say? By this gospel, you are saved. This is what saves you. All right. Is he going to talk about religious rule keeping? Is he going to do, what's he going to say saves us, right? If you hold firmly to the word I preach you, otherwise you believed in vain. It goes on. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. This isn't just important, it's first importance. If I say, y'all are going to tell you something about our church that's of first importance, you'd be like, what's he going to say? You know, I don't want to tell you about number 17 on the list. I want to tell you about number one. He's talking about the number one thing of first importance as it relates to the truth. Look at what it says. That Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures. See, the book talks about the truth. That he was buried and that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures. This is what the book talks about, is him. The book is not him. He is him, but the book talks about him. Amen? It talks about it. It goes on. And he appeared. Not only that, he appeared to all these disciples. Look at all the people it says he appeared to. And then it says, and last of all, he appeared to me. Paul's writing this. He's like, he appeared to me. I was persecuting him. I was putting his followers in jail. That's what Paul was doing. And then he appeared to me. Y'all, has the risen Christ appeared to you? I'm not talking about the book, man. I'm talking about Jesus, who's been raised from the dead. I mean, that's what you need. That is truth. He has appeared to us. He is alive. This is what it says, all right? And it goes on. Check this out. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how come some of you say there's no resurrection? See, what was happening was some people were coming in, oh, that's not true. Remember, the truth is keeping all. There were religious rule keepers coming into the Corinthian church saying, you know that thing Paul told you? That's not true. That Jesus thing about, no, you gotta live right, man. Some of y'all ain't living right. And Paul's like, no. That's not the truth. That's not the belt of truth. And so he goes on. If there is no resurrection from the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. Duh, right? And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless. And so is your faith. So what I would say to you is this. If Christ has not been raised from the dead, y'all should just get up and go now. This is stupid what we're doing if this ain't true. That's what he's saying. He's like, it's the resurrection. It's the person of Jesus. Truth is a person and an event. It's not a book. The book talks about it, but the truth is a person and an event and what he did. Man, this is unbelievable, isn't it? I mean, he came back from the dead. More and more I think about this, I go, you know what? I'm not a Christian because I follow a book about Jesus. I'm a Christian because I follow Jesus. Amen? Are you a Christian because you follow a book about Jesus? Or are you a Christian because you follow Jesus himself? Why would I spend so much time on this today? Because this is where your power comes from, friends. In fact, I would tell you, for those of you who are worried about this, because this is what happens. There are two kinds of people in here. Some of you, if you're not a Christian, you'd be like, this is great, man. I can follow Jesus and do whatever the bleepity bleep I want. It's all about relationship, man. Some people love this message, and they tune me out for the rest of what I'm about to say. But others of you who already are Christians, who say, yeah, I'm going to follow Jesus, it's important to hear both of these, all right, for both kinds of people. If you follow Jesus, here's what happens, all right, just you walk in with, you follow, and Jesus never said, you got to believe intellectually in me. That's not what he said. What did he say? To everybody, he said, follow me. Come with me. Let's go. And they started following him. A lot of people left him because they're like, it's too hard. Because guess what? when you follow Jesus, he's going to be like, so I'm going to be real honest with y'all. Yesterday, I came real close to a sin that I didn't want to commit, but I almost did. Personally, I'm telling you about me. I'm letting you into my life. And I was like, I can't do that. And see, I was, instead of just the book says, I was like talking to Jesus. And like his spirit in me, it says in scripture, the Holy Spirit is a whole other thing. If you're not a Christian, his spirit lives in us. I know that's weird, but he's like talking to me. I didn't hear an audible voice or nothing, but I'm like talking to Jesus. I'm like, I can't do that. And plus I was like, I'm not going to be able to preach on this tomorrow if I do that. I feel guilty. Preaching is one of the best accountabilities for my life, y'all. Some of y'all need to get up here. You need some more accountability. Amen. I mean, it's hard to be up here. I'm just telling you, it is hard. If you've ever been up here, right? Or you ever, I mean, and that's what I mean when I baptize a baby and I'm like, y'all want to, I'm basically saying all of us are on display. It matters, amen, what we're doing. But listen, if you follow Jesus, he's going to talk to you. And he's going to tell, you're going to go, Jesus, I'd like to sleep with this person before I get married. You know what he's going to say to you? Nah, let's not do that. We're not doing that. Was that a rule? No, man, it's a relationship. It's a relationship. But see, when it's just a rule, you know, oh, I don't like that. But if you're following Jesus, what happens? You had to deal with the relationship. I'm about to break the relationship. See, that's the thing that matters is the what? The relationship. And you got to deal with the reality that, man, it's the relationship. There's love, there's forgiveness, there's all this. I'm not, if you've done that or you're doing that or you're, listen, Jesus loves you. He'll pull you back in and he'll keep walking. That's what's so amazing about him, because it's not about you keeping the rules. But as you live, is this making sense? If you're having that thought, some of y'all, like, I'm just, this is what some of y'all do. I'm so unworthy. God can't love me. God, I've done this myself. Look at what I've done. And see what Jesus is going to say is, no, that's not true. That's not true. I love you. I died for you. You want to walk with me, Jesus? Yeah, I want to walk with you. Let's go. And so he's going to help you live the way that you need to live. So don't get concerned, religious people. It'll work out. Amen. Y'all with me? I know I'm being a little, but it's about what? Following the person. That's the truth. Jesus is the truth. And y'all, who wants freedom in the house today? Freedom. You want freedom. See, what's crazy and ironic, this is the irony, is you think freedom is not being bound up by that. Oh, I don't want that belt, man. It's like tight. And I'm telling you, man, it's the greatest freedom when you put that on. You put Jesus on. You put the truth on. It binds you up. It tightens it. You, oh, I'm loose there. I'm loose here. I need to fix that. It gives you, oh, I can't do that. I got to do. Listen, you're either going to be a slave to sin or a slave to Jesus. Which belt are you going to put on? I want the belt of truth. I want Jesus. I want that relationship. And so the belt of truth is available today, right here, right now. And you can pick it up and you can put it on, friends, and you can wear it, because that's freedom. Jesus said this in John chapter 8, if the Son has set you free, not if the book has set, it doesn't say if the book has set you free. It says if the Son, that is himself, has set you free, then you are what? Truly free. If you want to be truly free in all your sin, in all your messed upness, see, don't, I've done this. You put that belt on, you say, oh, I'm terrible, man. I don't want to be this close to Jesus. I'm in the light. And all he does is embrace you, man. Amen. He embraces you. It was the greatest freedom of my life. When I stopped trying to earn God's salvation. You're looking at the biggest earner in the room, my friends. I'm the biggest performer in the room. I fake it better than anybody else. When I let that go and I said, I'm a sinner, I'm messed up, I'm broken. You still want me? I love you. I want you. That's the truth. Amen? That's freedom.